Everyone gets bored at work or at school, but for some folks, staying focused on a task is really difficult. And it's not because they're lazy or not intelligent. Sometimes, having a hard time focusing can be caused by an underlying neurological condition, like ADHD. ADHD, or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, is sometimes perceived as a made-up condition that lets doctors and parents over-medicate energetic little Jimmy to make him easier to handle. But ADHD has been around for a long time. Its symptoms were first described in the early 1900s, and it's a real condition that affects a lot of people, including some of my friends.
My name is Stephen Brown. I'm a 36-year-old Caucasian male. I'm a microbiologist and bioinformaticist at UCSD. I'm a postdoc right now. Married to Cindy.
I'm Cindy. I am 32. I am a medical student at UC San Diego. I'm in the last 6 months of my 8-year MD-PhD program, and I guess I have ADHD.
Well, I don't actually know when I was first diagnosed. I know when I was first diagnosed most recently that I've been treated for. It was 5 or 6 years ago. I had just switched to academic postdoc position from a brief stint working in the finance industry after graduate school. And I felt like I was having trouble staying focused on what I was doing, that I was kind of maybe switching tasks a little too often. Like I could just stay focused and get one thing more done, but instead I would jump between things. I tried a few different systems where I would like schedule half an hour, set a timer, right? Work on the thing for half an hour. But I just kept finding that even when I was trying to stay focused in that half an hour, that I was fighting this really intense battle in my own head. It was just much harder than it felt like it should be. So I made an appointment with a psychiatrist, and he said, you know, based on just that first conversation, that I had garden variety ADHD without the hyperactivity. So I guess it's the inattentive subtype. So my reaction to the diagnosis was, I was actually kind of excited about it because if I did actually have ADHD, then it was something that I could maybe manage in addition to, you know, having trouble getting things done. It caused me a lot of stress to not be getting those things done. And as a result, I had a lot of anxiety around that. And so to maybe have the possibility of treating that was, I was just, that was very exciting for me.
I was diagnosed 3 or 4 months ago. The way it actually came up was that I had gone to my psychologist for what I thought was a different set of things, and I still don't really know how interrelated they are. I had gone because I was applying to med schools, and it was extremely stressful. I was having a really hard time feeling confident. And I thought it had gotten better, that I could talk about it without this again.
Can I get you a tissue?
So I'd gone to him for that, and while there, we were trying to pick apart, like, why. We were trying to pick apart why I felt so insecure about things in general. Like, definitely never felt like I was as good as the other med students or as good as the other grad students. On paper, I can write the same thing, but I never feel like I earned it. Like, I never feel like I put in nearly as many hours into studying for med school as some other med students, or that I spent nearly as much time in lab as some other grad students. And I always attribute it to kind of a lack of discipline. Like, I just can't focus for that long on a thing. And so, like, when he heard that, he kind of latched onto this whole, like, discipline thing. Like, why does it have to be discipline? You know, could it be an attention thing? He's like, I'm gonna refer you to a psychiatrist to be evaluated for ADHD. What do you feel about that? My initial reaction was kind of like, yeah, what's new? But I'm still trying to figure out how much it affects my day-to-day and how much of it is personality and how much of it is something that I want to change or feel needs to change.
ADHD affects about 5% of the population, and it's more commonly diagnosed in boys than in girls at a rate of about 3 boys for every 1 girl. But that may be partially the result of the fact that it can be harder to recognize the symptoms in girls. Symptoms usually start to show up when kids are between 3 and 6 years old and can continue into adulthood, although some adults may outgrow it.
So I don't know if I was diagnosed as a child ever. There were a couple of times where my parents were worried about me for reasons that I didn't really understand or at least don't remember, and I saw a psychologist, but I don't remember any detailed conversations about it. I do know that when I told my parents about it after I was diagnosed and started treatment, that they didn't seem really surprised. So I kind of wonder if this was something that they got hints of. I used to do this thing where I blow spit bubbles with my mouth, and the teachers found that really annoying. And so what I kind of wonder is, maybe, you know, I would just do things to amuse myself because I wasn't focusing on the lessons, but like sitting in class wasn't a thing where I was learning a lot. It was reading the book and working the exercises where I learned. And it was only later when I got into sort of more unstructured jobs when I started to run into some trouble. So did I have it as a kid? Was I diagnosed as a kid? I can certainly see how my behavior patterns as a child would fit with what later became, as I know it, to be ADHD.
I kind of always had the idea that perhaps I might have like ADHD. I think my parents also, when I was younger, thought that I had ADHD. They'd never felt the need for me to go see a psychologist or to be medicated because I was getting good grades. I had friends, kept out of trouble. But I talked a lot and I got in trouble for that a lot. And I was always trying to run around and climb on things and jump off things. So when I was actually diagnosed, it wasn't really that surprising.
ADHD is a complex condition with a lot of different symptoms, but most of them are related to issues with goal-oriented behaviors. Things like paying attention, staying focused, and seeing tasks through to the end. There are three different subtypes of ADHD, and each is defined by their primary symptoms. People with the primarily inattentive subtype tend to be easily distracted and forgetful. They lose track of time and have a hard time focusing on tasks. This subtype can be more difficult to identify and diagnose. And related to what I was saying earlier, girls are more likely to have this kind of ADHD. People who are primarily hyperactive impulsive, on the other hand, are often fidgety and impatient, have a hard time controlling their impulses, and are very talkative. In adults, this kind of ADHD can appear as an inner restlessness rather than outward movement. And the third subtype is the combination subtype, with a mixture of inattentive and hyperactive symptoms. All three of these subtypes can include other symptoms of ADHD, including difficulty managing anger and poor handwriting. And sometimes ADHD can result in developmental delays, or it can co-occur with other neurodevelopmental conditions like epilepsy, Tourette syndrome, OCD, and autism.
For me, I definitely have more of the hyperactive, impulsive type of ADHD than the inattentive type. We were getting ingredients for pizza, and Steve was like, should I clean the house while you go to the grocery store, or do you want to clean the house while I go to the grocery store? I'm like, you go to the grocery store, because you'll actually come back with the things I tell you to bring back. If I go, I'm going to get distracted and come back with a whole bunch of other things. That happens a lot.
In social situations, before I started taking the medication, I could not remember people's names to save my life. I would be introduced at a party, hi, I'm Bob, hi, I'm Steve, and I would forget in the next sentence what their name was. I just couldn't. And it would be this really intense conversation right up until the end, and then I'd go to say goodbye and I couldn't remember their name, and this is like very kind of stressful for me, and I think kind of awkward for a lot of people involved.
Like so many other complex neurological conditions, it's not totally clear what causes ADHD, but there seems to be some kind of genetic component. Siblings of kids with ADHD are 3 to 4 times as likely to have it themselves compared to families without ADHD. Genome-wide association studies, which use big data sets to look for patterns across the entire human genome, have found a relationship between genes involved in dopamine transmission and ADHD. Dopamine is commonly known as one of the reward molecules of the brain, but it's important for lots of other things too, like controlling decision-making, movement, and motivation. There are environmental factors that play a role too. For example, fetal alcohol syndrome, exposure to certain chemicals, and particular types of infections like the measles during pregnancy or early childhood can all increase the likelihood of an ADHD diagnosis or cause ADHD-like symptoms. One of the reasons we know that ADHD is a real condition is that doctors have been studying it for a while now. Using fMRI research, which studies brain activation by measuring blood flow, scientists have found changes in a bunch of different brain regions. One of the most well-known changes is that kids with ADHD have reduced activation in the inferior frontostriatal circuit compared to kids without ADHD during motor inhibition tasks. This means that kids with ADHD had less activation in the circuit that helps us prevent motion. Many other brain regions show decreased activation too, including a bunch of regions associated with controlling movement, like the supplementary motor area, the anterior cingulate cortex, the right striatum, and the left thalamus. People with ADHD also showed reduced activation in the right dorsal attention network, which could be a key part of the inattentive type of ADHD. Overall, most of the changes seen in the ADHD brain are decreases in signaling in circuits that are important for controlling impulses, and in networks that help control attention. A lot of the problems seem to be related to the communication between the frontal lobe, which is the brain's executive processing center, and the regions responsible for coordinating various behaviors. All of these results are based on meta-analysis of large sets of research studies, but it's always important to remember that fMRI research can't tell us everything. Like, it doesn't tell us exactly which neurotransmitters are involved. Also, this work has focused primarily on kids. Only a few studies have looked at adults with ADHD, but the studies that do look at adults have found similar results. Now, ADHD is treated a couple of different ways. Micah will talk about clinical therapeutic approaches in another video, so for now I'll just say that therapy can be effective in mild to moderate cases, particularly when it comes to helping folks with ADHD learn strategies to stay organized and helping patients recognize their own behavioral patterns to help mitigate the effects. Medication is another effective treatment for ADHD, though, of course, it's not without its controversy. Most folks have heard about popular ADHD medications like Adderall or Ritalin because they're sometimes abused, often by students who are just trying to boost their study skills. These drugs are not some sort of limitless drug that unlocks your brain's capacity. They're actually just stimulants, which seems like a weird thing to give to a person with a hyperactivity problem. But if you look at the brain rather than the behavior, it makes a lot of sense. Scientists think these drugs increase the availability of norepinephrine and dopamine in the brain. Since part of ADHD is thought to be related to problems in dopamine signaling, it makes sense that these drugs might help.
So I'm on a very small dose of Ritalin, like it's 5 mg. It's about as small as you can get. For me, I don't feel like it's a stimulant in that I don't feel like I have more energy. For me, it kind of just makes the anxiety like tone down a little bit.
You put me on 20 milligrams of extended release Adderall, and I take that every morning. The biggest difference I've noticed is that I'm far more relaxed. My approach to conversations at social events is much more focused.
Adderall and Ritalin both have similar effects in that they help improve focus and reduce impulsive behavior. But they aren't without their side effects, which can include difficulty sleeping, loss of appetite, nervousness, headaches, and more.
When I first started taking the medication, actually the very first day that I took it, I very distinctly remember being in the car and like suddenly there was this intense rush of like all these things that I could be doing, right? And it almost felt like it was exacerbating it. And I felt like, oh my gosh, maybe this is just gonna make things worse. And that first day was a little weird, not gonna lie. But what I'd been told was that there's sort of, you have to kind of adjust to it. And so there's like these immediate effects, but then, you know, you keep taking it and sort of the immediate effects don't really have the same impact as they once did. And it was really remarkable. On the second day, that didn't happen. And it hasn't actually ever happened since.
Sometimes other medications are prescribed too, especially when the ADHD is comorbid with something else, like depression or anxiety. Ultimately, it's up to the person affected by ADHD and their families to decide what approach is best for them. The debate is ongoing as to the true prevalence of ADHD and how it's best treated. And since ADHD medications are stimulants that can be easily abused, there's a real concern regarding overprescription to children.
Parents might not want to give their child stimulants, or they people have observed that maybe ADHD isn't so much a disease as it is a product of the social environment and the economic environment that we live in. And I'm kind of fascinated by that as a possibility. Maybe this isn't a disease so much of me here now as it is a change in the way that humans are expected to be in the world just because of, I don't know, industrialization and all this other, who knows what. You know, it's fun to talk about, but it's also not something I can do much about. And it's okay. It's fine. Like, everybody's got their problems. I feel really lucky in my life. I've got a lot of good things that I'm very grateful for. And if that's the cross I have to bear, cool. We're good. Totally fine.
Researchers are working to better understand the biological underpinnings of ADHD so they can develop more targeted therapies. But however it's treated, it's a real condition, and it's important that people with ADHD have access to the resources and medications they need to succeed. Do you have thoughts or feelings about ADHD and how it's viewed by society? Let us know in the comments. Huge thank you to our friends Cindy and Steve for their help with this video. We're always so inspired by the willingness of our friends to share their experiences. Until our next transmission, I'm Allie Astrocyte. Over and out.